Well, good morning and welcome to Gracewood's Church Online Experience. My name is Justin and we're so glad that you've joined us today. If it's your first time watching, we're so glad you're here and wanted to give you an opportunity to let us know you were here by clicking on that welcome button up at the top of the screen. And when you do this, you'll be taken to a short form that'll give you the opportunity to let us know that you were here with us today. We want to know about your visit with us online today, and we hope that you enjoy the rest of the church experience this morning. Before we continue in our time of worship, I wanted to give you a couple of quick but important announcements this morning. First off, if you've been watching, you know that both global and local missions are important to us here at Gracewood, and we want to continue to provide opportunities for you to take part in those ministries. The best way to do that at this time is through your generosity and your prayers. We are continuing the important work with Crosspoint International Ministries and our sister church in Honduras, Philadelphia Baptist Church, to accept donations to put towards food and other necessities for those who have suffered in Central America with not only COVID-19, but to provide food and aid to the victims of the twin hurricanes that hit back in November. There's still a lot of work to be done and a lot of needs to be met. So we want to encourage you to pray about giving to this important need. You can donate online at gracewood.church or in the Gracewood app. Or if you prefer, you can mail a donation to Gracewood Community Church and simply put Hurricane Relief in the memo. We greatly appreciate your continued generosity that is being put to work in Honduras and Nicaragua even now. We also have an important announcement regarding our in-person services. So beginning Sunday, January 10th, that's next week, we will resume both of our in-person services at 9:30 and 11 a.m. and we'll continue to provide the online experience as well. And we hope that you'll join us for one of those options next week. Now, we're just about ready to begin worship, but before we do that, let's take just a moment to remember the promises our God has made us, His people, and how His faithfulness will always endure. For all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes. And through Christ, our amen, which means yes, ascends to God for His glory. It is God who enables us, along with you, to stand firm for Christ. He has commissioned us, and He has identified us as His own by placing the Holy Spirit in our hearts as the first installment that guarantees everything He has promised us.
Silence is the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. So let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. So let it song that overcomes the raging sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside me. So let it rise. Let faith arise. Heaven sounds like we praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. Watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever intimate with the creation cry. We're gonna see you break. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever intimate with all creation cry, God, we praise you. We praise you. We praise you. We praise you. Back my praise, I gotta let it out. I can't hold back my praise, I gotta let it out. I can't hold back my praise. Come on, I gotta let it out. I can't hold back my praise, I gotta let it out. I can't hold back my praise, I gotta let it out. I can't hold back my this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. You cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever intimate with all creation cry, God, we praise you. We praise you. Oh, we praise you.
Restore every heart that is is broken and great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs.
It's your breath in our lungs,
we pour out our breath.
Come on, lift him up. We'll sing it. It's your breath.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You're so great, God. Great are you, Lord.
Come on, sing that together. Great are you, Lord.
Great are you, Lord. And great are you,
Happy New Year, everybody, and welcome to Gracewood Community Church Online. My name is Tim Brown, lead pastor at Gracewood Community Church, and I'm honored that you would spend your very first Sunday of the year with us as we're kicking off 2021 with a series that I think will help us move in the right direction. It's called All Things New, and we're praying that's what God does this year. And as we think about new things, I think it's extremely important to think back and to remember the faithfulness of God in our lives so that we have the foundation for Him to continue to build these new things that we're talking about. And there is no doubt that God is doing something new. Now, I don't know how many of you guys have ever experienced a day that may not be one of the best. Maybe an old friend from the past finds a box of photos that they have up in their attic, and they decide that today is the day that they shall be posted all to Facebook, you know, the ones that you were in, you know, all the crazy ones, and they tagged you in every last one of them. Unbelievable, right? Can you say, remove tag, please, right? But pictures many times tell us things about people. They also help us to remember better. And it's fun to remember things, isn't it? It's fun sometimes to look back and think about all of the things that transpired in our lives. In fact, remembering is something that many times is ingrained in us. We want to remember anniversaries, or at least we hope to remember those things, don't we, gentlemen? I mean, we try to remember our anniversaries. We remember birthdays of loved ones. We like to reminisce over good times. I mean, think about how many of your best conversations begin with, hey, do you remember when? And then you fill in the blank, right? Well, you know, sometimes it's like the smell of something, isn't it? Like a perfume or a cologne that will take you back to that first date. Or maybe the smell of peanut butter pie baking will take you back to grandma's house. It just conjures up all of these memories. So remembering is something that's really important to us. And not only is it important to us, it's also very important to God. We see this all throughout the Old Testament. When God would move on behalf of His people, He would have them put up stone pillars or an altar of some sort, and He would tell them, hey, when someone asks you about this, you tell them what I've done. Remember what God has done in your life. Now, if I were to tell you that today would be the last opportunity that you had to be able to speak to those that you love, you would probably begin to think of, you know, what do I want to say? What do I want to do if it is really, truly the last opportunity that I have to be with them? Well, we actually see this scenario played out in Luke chapter 22 when Jesus is spending one of His last moments with His disciples. Here they are, and they're having this celebration over the Passover meal, and then all of a sudden, Jesus picks up some bread, and He breaks it, and He said, this is My body, which is given for you. Do this in what? Do this in remembrance of Me. And likewise, the cup after they had eaten, He said,
"This is my blood of the new covenant shed for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me," is what he says. In Jesus' last moments, he chooses to give them a symbol and an act of remembrance because he knew how critical it was for them as his followers to remember who he was and what he had done. Remembering, it's important to God. So why does God want us to remember? Well, remembering God's faithfulness in the past allows us to trust him in the present. That's what it does. Remembering God's faithfulness in the past allows us to trust him in the present. We see this vividly portrayed in Deuteronomy chapter 7. Now, I'll give you a little context here. This is Moses speaking, and he's about to be done with the Israelites. You know, he's going to be going up on the mountain, and he's not going to get to go over into the promised land, right? They've been wandering around in the wilderness for 40 years, and they're about to go into the promised land. It's kind of his farewell speech, if you will. So Moses is getting ready to say some things. Now, there's this one little problem. There are people in the promised land, okay? They're already inhabiting this place where God said they were going to go and the Israelites were going to take over this land. But the Israelites are a little bit concerned and they're not going to be able to stand up against this enemy that's in the land that God had promised to them. And this is what Moses tells them in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 17 through 19. "You may say to yourselves, 'These nations are stronger than we are. How can we drive them out?' But do not be afraid of them." What does he say? Help me out here. He says, "Remember. Remember well what the Lord your God did to Pharaoh and to all of Egypt. You saw it with your own eyes, the great trials, the signs, the wonders, the mighty hand and the outstretched arm with which the Lord your God brought you out. The Lord your God will do the same to all the peoples you now fear." What is it that you need to remember today? Maybe it's a time when God moved in a huge way on your behalf, and there's no way in the world you could do this. And God showed up and did it, and you remember his faithfulness. And in that time, it helps you because like all of us, we go through times where we are really, really tight with God. And then there are other times where we feel more distant, right? And it's in those distant times that sometimes we can find ourselves beginning to doubt God's faithfulness. And what we have to remember is God's faithfulness is in our lives and it's been there the whole time. And the thing that he has done, the things that he has done, we have to remember those things because it allows us to trust in him in the present. But many times as Christ followers, we actually remember the wrong things and we forget all the right things, don't we? But I'm telling you, I've seen it time and time again in my life and in the lives of other people where God steps up and I can remember his faithfulness and it allows me to trust him in a very uncertain present to begin to know that he will come through and he will deliver me and he will deliver you and he will do a great work making all things new. I remember God's faithfulness in the past and it allows me to trust him in the present. The second thing is this, okay? Remembering God's faithfulness in the past directs our actions in the future. It directs our actions in the future. Okay, now this is portrayed very well in a story that's very well known throughout Scripture, and it's the perfect underdog story of a young shepherd boy, David, who slayed a giant named Goliath. All right, many of you have heard this, and you've heard the story. You may be familiar with it, but I do wonder, how did David, this little shepherd boy, get to a place where he thought that he could take on Goliath, a giant standing over 9 feet tall, a trained warrior from his youth, a guy who had armor and a spear that was heavier than most young children, you know, and an armor bearer? How could this young little boy go at him with nothing but a sling? What's the deal? Well, we're going to pick up this story in 1 Samuel chapter 17. David now has gone to the king, all right, King Saul, and he said, "Hey, you know what? I want to go at this guy. Nobody else is wanting to fight this guy, and he's been taunting the armies of our living God. And you know what? I want a piece of him. I want to take him down, and I believe that I can take him down." And he tells Saul, "I am going to do this." And Saul says, "Hey, listen, I know you're all fired up and you're all ready to go about this, young David, but listen, you're just You're just a little shepherd boy. So just chill. I don't really think that you can take him out. And here's what happens in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 34 through 37. It says this, "But David said to Saul, 'Your servant has been keeping his father's sheep. When a lion or a bear came and carried off the sheep from the flock, I went after it, struck it, and rescued the sheep from its mouth. When it turned on me, I seized it by its hair, struck it, and killed it. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear. This uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, because he has defied the armies of the living God. The Lord, who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine.'" David's like, somebody's got to step aside and give me a stone, because my God, who I remember has delivered me from the lion, who has delivered me from the bear, this guy, he's going to be just like one of them. What's David doing? Well, he's remembering. He's remembering what God did in his life. And I love the cocky God confidence that David begins to feel. It just makes you want to go out there and take something on, right? And it's because David remembered God's faithfulness. What is it that you need to remember today? Maybe your marriage is in a really bad place. But let me remind you of the covenant, the vow that you made when you stood before God and you said, for better or for worse. And it may feel worse right now. But with God's help, and you leaning in and following him, it will get better. You have to stay in the game, all right? And maybe it's that you've been praying for a wayward child for years and years and years. Let me remind you of what God's word says. It says in the book of Proverbs that you train up a child in the way they should go, and when they're old, they will not depart from it. It's a promise from Scripture. Let me remind you of what God's word says, all right? Continue to pray, continue to pursue that child, because as God's word says, they will come back. And maybe it's that feeling like, you know what? My life is going nowhere fast right now. And you just feel this sense of despair and doubt, and I don't understand, and I don't know what's going on. I don't know about this. And let me remind you of what God's word says. In the book of Jeremiah, God says, "I know the plans I have for you. I've got plans to give you a hope and a future, a sense of purpose, something to be about in your life." God's word says it. And today you say, you know what? I remember that. And with God's help, I'm going to step into my calling and I'm going to find this thing out, right? And God's going to give me a purpose beyond myself. What is it that you need to remember? Now, I do want to acknowledge something. It's that there are those of you who are sitting there today and you're watching this message and you say, you know what? I don't want to remember anything about my life. It's terrible. I don't even want to remember it, okay? Well, let me tell you something that you need to hear today. You may very well feel that way about your past, but I want you to hear this. God will take all things and work them out for good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And so hang on to that, all right? And also, understand this. Even though you may have made some really poor decisions in the past, here's the deal. Starting today, the decisions that you make today determine your memories for tomorrow. Let that sink in for you, because the decisions that you make today determine your memories for tomorrow. The fact that you're watching this message right now tells me that God is speaking to you. He has a plan for you, a future, and a hope. And the decisions you begin to make, starting with this one today that you've watched this message, God will utilize that. And you are making memories for tomorrow. Remembering is incredibly important. We've already looked at it, and Jesus talked about how important it was when he set the standard long ago. We've talked about some of the different things that remembering can do. But here's the deal. We all know that it's important to remember. But the fact of the matter is, we just don't do it very well, do we? If you're anything like me, you know, my wife calls me on the way home and I'm going to the store and says, "Hey, can you pick up a few things? Can you pick up like four things?" And she goes, do you need to write that down? You know, do I need to text you? And I'm like, four things? Absolutely not. I got this. I got this. So I get to the store and I go and I pick up the bread and I pick up the milk and I'm like, man, you know, this is killing me. I'm going to have to make that phone call, that humbling phone call where I'm like, hey, honey, you know, I've got the milk, I've got the bread. What were the other things that you said? And she's like, oh, you didn't write it down, did you? And, you know, we don't always remember what we need to. So how do we do that? Well, let's look at that. We're going to talk about two different, very easy, very applicable ways that we can remember. Okay, so how do we remember? The first thing is so, so simple. Write it down. You write it down. This comes out of a story that I'm going to tell you from Joshua chapter 3. It's kind of continuing on the story out of Deuteronomy that we just talked about just a minute ago. And we talked about this one some last week, where the Israelites are about to go over into Canaan, the promised land, and they're about to go over and inhabit this land, all right? Well, here's the deal. They start to go, and all of a sudden, they come up against the Jordan River. And they're like, oh, wait, what do we do now, you know? Now, the Bible records that the Jordan River is actually at flood stages at this point, okay? So they come up to this, and they're like, now what in the world are we going to do? Well, God instructs Joshua. He says, you take the priests who are carrying the Ark of the Covenant, and you tell them to go stand in the middle of the river. Go stand in the middle of the river. So they start to go out, and check this out. The second that their feet, the feet of the priests hit the side of the river, it's like, boom, and the water stands up. I can't even imagine, but I bet that there was somebody there that was in that camp that said, I remember when God did this once before. Can you say the Red Sea, right? Moses stretches out his staff and God parts the sea. Remember that? This is how God is going to deliver us once again. And so they cross the Jordan River on dry ground. And then Joshua, through God, says in Joshua chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, go over before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, your God, into the middle of the Jordan. Each of you is to take up one stone, put it on his shoulder, according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites, to serve as a sign among you. Hey, I want you to go back and I want you to pick up 12 stones from the middle of this river and you bring them back and you build a pillar. Remember earlier we talked about the fact that it's important to God? He says, when I move on your behalf, I want you to remember it. So they build a pillar of 12 stones. In essence, this was them writing it down. Now, I understand today we have lots of different ways to remember things. Sometimes it's in pictures, right? A picture's worth 1,000 words. Sometimes it may be for you. Maybe you like to blog, or maybe you like to video blog. And so you just capture everything on a video, and that's fine. Whatever it is for you, however God uniquely gets you to do it, you need to write it down. You need to remember what God has done in your life. And it may be a lot like what happened to Moses in Numbers chapter 11, when God was talking to Moses, and Moses is kind of venting to God a bit, and he says, oh God, I wish you wouldn't have ever made me lead these Israelites. You know, they just whine and they complain all the time. You know, they complain so much. I wish you would have killed me rather than make me lead these people. These are terrible people, basically. And now, God, what they want is they want meat. They don't want manna anymore. They want meat. Okay? And God's like, okay, well, I'll give them some meat. In fact, I'll give them so much meat that it'll be coming out of their nostrils. It'll be running out of their nostrils. And Moses is like, yeah, well, you know, God, I've got a lot of people down here. I don't know that we can really do this. That's a lot of meat, God. I mean, I don't really know. And God just stops Moses. And he just says this. And this is a phrase that God used. And I believe he may use it to speak to you today. He just says, Moses, is the Lord's arm too short? Is the Lord's arm too short? And God showed his faithfulness once again. These are things that we must write down. The second thing that you got to do is you've got to tell others about it. You've got to tell others about it. It's not just good enough to write it down. We have to tell others about it. In fact, if we don't remember, if we don't tell others, many times in the future, for the future generations, they're just going to be destined to repeat the same mistakes that we did in our past. It's so much better when we can learn from the experiences of others. Those of you who are parents, I promise you one thing that I know about you. You really, really, really wish that your children would not make the same mistakes that you made growing up. You wish that they could know God's faithfulness and know His goodness in a way that you didn't know when you were young. And let me promise you one thing. If you don't write down what God has done in your life and how He's provided for you, you're going to forget it. And they will end up repeating the same mistakes that you did. It's that important. Write it down. Tell others about it. Because just like with the story that we see in Numbers chapter 11, if it had not been written down and the story had not been told, we would not be able to learn from it and for it to have the power to change our lives. Is the Lord's arm too short? I pray that phrase sticks with you. There's something you're going through and you need to say, is the Lord's arm too short? We know that it's not. That's scripture. Numbers chapter 11, verse 23. That's what God wanted you to hear today. Because I've told it. It's impacted you. Simple stuff. Write it down. Tell others about it. Now, when you tell others about it, the beautiful thing is that you start to see, as you see in Joshua chapter 4, verse 6 through 7, he says, in the future, when your children ask, not if they ask, but children are going to ask a bazillion questions. We know that. So when they ask, you know, what do these stones mean? Tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. And when it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. These stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel forever. You tell them of God's faithfulness. What is it that you need to write down and tell other people about so that they can know the faithfulness of God? Today, I remember what has happened in my past so that I can trust Him in the present. And He will begin to make all things new. Would you pray with me today? Father, I pray today that You would just help us to remember all the things that You have done in our lives. The things that were good and the things that were bad, because You work in all things for those who love You and are called according to Your purpose. God, I pray that You would help us as we do that. As you're praying today, there are those of you who would say, you know what, Tim? As you're talking about this, that's exactly what I need to do. I need to write down what it is that God's done in my life. I need to remember it, and I need to tell others about it, and I need to do it on a consistent basis. If that's you, I want to challenge you to commit to doing it, and I want to pray for you right now. Father, I pray that for all of us that know, God, I want to remember the stuff that You've done in my life. I pray that You would help us to remember the things that You have done, the things that You've walked us through. And God, I pray that when You remind us of those things, that we would have the faithfulness to write them down and then to tell others about it, to tell our story. As we continue praying, there are those of you who are watching and maybe you're thinking, I don't have a relationship with Jesus. And maybe today you want to surrender your life to Him. Because listen, God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, Jesus Christ, to die in our place on the cross so that we can be forgiven of our sins. The Bible says that we all, every single one of us, myself included, everybody has fallen short of God's standard. And here's the thing, we can't be good enough or work our way to God. We need a Savior. And those of you who would say, Jesus, come in, take over, be my Lord and be my Savior. I want you to pray this prayer. I want you to believe it in your heart and follow Jesus for the rest of your life. Pray this. Pray, Heavenly Father, thank You for dying on the cross as the sacrifice for my sin. I accept Your forgiveness. Help me to live for You every day of my life and to walk in Your ways. My life is no longer my own. Today, I give it all to You. And it's in the name of Jesus that I pray. And everybody said, amen.